Well, let me be real clear. I've said nothing about infringing on the Sixth Amendment constitutional right of representation. I'm talking about when the adversarial process gets to the point of a trial, there has to be a trial. It has nothing to do with whether or not you're going to appoint an attorney in the pre-trial process to afford someone their Sixth Amendment right. I'm not sure what Ms. Brumbelow heard, but that's not what I said.
Okay.
This is for both of you. Mr. Barton, you be first. What experience do you have in family law, criminal law, and civil law?
As the criminal district attorney, you're going to spend the majority of your time working within criminal law, obviously. So my expertise, if you think like a doctor, most doctors are not going to be a generalist, they're going to be a specialist. So you can think of a prosecutor as a specialist in criminal law, but that doesn't mean that you're confined to just criminal law. Within the DA's office, I'm responsible for prosecuting child abuse and neglect cases with the Texas Department of Family Protective Services. That constitutes about 5% of the docket. I've been doing that. Was my first job out of law school, was to represent the department. Also in the DA's office, I have prosecuted civil cases. This is asset seizure forfeiture, where I've taken money off of the streets with the collaboration of law enforcement to put tax, non-tax revenue back into the county coffers. Hundreds of thousands of dollars. I've added vehicles, I've added personnel. So my expertise is predominantly criminal, as it hurts as family, but I also have experience in family, through CPS, and civil, and asset seizure forfeiture.
Ms. Brumbelow?
I have 20 years worth of experience in general civil litigation, which is everything from real estate disputes to personal injury, basically anything that's not family law or criminal law. I have at least 15 years worth of experience in criminal defense. I have 1 year worth of experience in criminal prosecution. I also have 13 plus years experience with family law, an area that I thought I would never practice, but was definitely in need for Zandt County and the surrounding areas. I have the most godlike legal background of any candidate here. I know what it takes to calculate child support. I know what it takes to determine what's in the best interest of the child. I know what it takes to engage in property division. I know the standards that have to be met in criminal cases, and I also know the standards that have to be met in civil cases. I've handled some of the most biggest and complex civil litigation matters, including patent law and trademark infringement, and also one of the most biggest and controversial criminal cases in the state of the United States.
Go ahead.
I would like clarification on what the biggest case in the history of the department.
The biggest case that I handled in history would be the state of Texas versus Patrick.
Okay, so my question to you, Ms. Brumbelow, is it true or is it not true that during that trial, you got on the witness stand as an attorney, and you were asked a question by the prosecutor on whether or not you introduced evidence into the record to circumvent a gag order, and your response was, I plead the Fifth Amendment. Is that true or not true?
Yes, that's very true. In fact, I have one of the people here that represented me at that particular time. In fact, there was no violation of the gag order otherwise, because the DA's office had already filed stamped it in with a foul mark. In fact, it was a mischievous and disingenuous attempt by the district attorney's office to circumvent and show, take the heat off of them. In fact, in that case, what happened is we found, in the 14th Court of Appeals, found that the Smith County District Attorney's Office violated the Brady rights of my client and reversed and remanded it back. My client is the only one without a criminal conviction.
Okay, no, move on. Next one.
See me afterwards. We'll talk further about it.
And talk to me about it as well, too.
Let the Fifth Amendment be she talks about it.
No, Mr. Martin. This will be to both of y'all. Outside of the criminal, civil, and family law trial issues in Zandt County, what other roles does the district court have in county affairs and county business? How would you, as the district judge, be the best qualified to serve in this other capacity?
Okay, if I understand the question, you're asking about eviction and the appointment of the auditors and stuff like that.
And administrative matters.
And the administrative matters, with regards to budget or otherwise. I can't say that I was prepared for this particular question, but I do know that, the district judge handles a lot of other things besides family law, including election contest, tax matters, malpractice matters, things of that nature. I can't say that I have any experience picking a county auditor or anything else like that, but I don't have a problem working with people. I don't have a problem getting along with people. And so I think I can grasp that knowledge rather quickly and work with the commissioners to do what I need to get done to fill the shoes that were so greatly filled by Judge Dragon.
Mark?
Well, I am prepared for the question. The district judge is responsible in a large part for participation on the Zandt County Juvenile Board in providing supervisory leadership to the Juvenile Probation Department. I, too, as a criminal district attorney, have been on that for 7 years. That's a statutory appointment. The leadership in that respect is very important. I already have that experience and will be able to take the ground running day one on that. Also, the district judge is responsible for the appointment of the auditor and the assistant auditors. Those are on contract basis. My wife is an assistant auditor for Zandt County for a number of years. I rely on her expertise even to this day when determining budgets for the Zandt County DA's office, and that's something that I would have as Brumbelow would not going forward, is the help and assistance of my wife with her financial gifts. A very close working relationship I have with the Zandt County Probation Department. The district judge has supervisory responsibilities over the probation department. I've enjoyed a great working relationship with them for the past 7 years.
I think it's important to recognize that I had several years of juvenile experience as well as whether or not I sat on that board or not. In fact, as a court-appointed attorney that represented juvenile defendants and tried one of those successful felony cases in Smith County in which they no longer saw at TYC. With regards to that, I do not have anything in the experience of my husband. I can't imagine my husband coming in doing the finances or helping me or assisting me with that. I would hope that I have somebody that is more transparent, that's not so close to me, which is exactly the biggest thing that a lot of people have been griping about. I do not have an insider on that. Thank you.
Next question, Ken.
Thank you. This one goes to Mr. Martin first, for both of you also. Have you reviewed the budget for the district court? If so, what would you do to make it run more efficient and cost effective? If not, why not?
Yes, I have reviewed the district court's budget. The annual budget this year is $1,025,000. I'm sorry, $250,515. Three quarters of that budget is compromised, comprised rather, of about $760,000 of the indigent legal defense. That's the most important aspect of the district court budget. That's where you, the taxpayers, feel the most pressure in the wallet. That is where you have to ensure that people are getting their Sixth Amendment rights afforded to them early in the process. You have to make sure that the attorneys that are billing that to you taxpayers, that the bills are being reviewed, that they're accurate, that there's no double billing, that there's no padding. That's something else that I have experience in doing consultating with my wife, who is responsible for that. And so, throughout these years, she's instructed me and informed me on ways to ensure that these things are not occurring. The way that you make it move quicker is that you communicate. You communicate with the litigants, you communicate with parties, not with ex parte hearings, but with the attorneys to determine what needs to go to trial, what can be mediated, what can be worked out. You just don't come in there with a gavel and say, it's going to be this way, because if you do that, you're going to be setting yourself up for failure.
Ms. Brumbelow?
Yes, I have not actually reviewed the budget. However, I've had extensive conversation with Judge Jones regarding the budget. Judge Jones knew what her budget was going to be when she decided not to seek re-election for this position. I believe that I am confident in the choices that are made by Judge Jones with regards to that. On the indigent defense, the issue that Mr. Martin talked about, again, I think he's selfish short on indigent defense, and eventually will be infringing on people's constitutional rights.
I am totally clueless on what is she's talking about, infringing people. There's no deprivation of indigent legal defense. I'm going to have to explain that to me later, Ms. Brumbelow. But I'll tell you this, for the past 7 years, I've been running $500,000 budget conservatively. I've met a conservative budget. I've come in under the number. I've kept my office in the black. while adding revenue from the pockets of criminal defendants back to you. I've added cars, I've added personnel, I've given money to law enforcement, I installed the first interview room at the Vanzant County Sheriff's Office at no cost to you. You need administrative experience and vision.
If we need administrative experience, I guess we need to talk about all the civil forfeiture deadlines that are also in this question mark as well that could have been created by running in this particular county. I guess you can select and choose which particular organizations you want to give to in December to see if back when you had like CASA, BAMPD, and KMP.
Okay, we're going to stop there. That's over the top. This will be the both of y'all. If you become aware of unethical conduct on the part of a trial advocate in a case in which you are presiding, how would you handle it? Do you believe judges should be required to report attorney misconduct? Ms. Brumbelow.
Everybody had a duty to report unethical conduct on behalf of an attorney. If you're a witness in court or just sitting in court being an observer, and I don't want to say a witness for specific proceedings, if you see somebody doing this unethical, you should report it. I believe the judge has a duty to report it as well. With regards to unethical conduct, the judge also has a duty to report substance and alcohol abuse that they see and seek intervention with regards to that.
Mr. Barton.
Should I suspect that there's unethical conduct occurring in the court, the first thing that I would do is I wouldn't accuse anyone. I would pull the party into the attorney into chambers. I would have to investigate and determine whether or not my perceived unethical conduct is what I believe it is. It may be trial strategy, it may be something else. So I'd have to investigate into that. Then if I do believe that it is substantiated by the evidence, then yes, you have to report it. You do have an ethical obligation to do that. Judicial Canon 1 and Judicial Canon 3 require judges to address attorney misconduct. Had I been the judge on the case that Ms. Brumbelow testified, refuse to answer.